Finally tonight, a West African country struggles to recover from years of conflict and aims to provide its citizens with very basic needs, including safe drinking water. Special correspondent Steve Sapienza has another of his collaborations with African journalists covering the continent's water issues. His story was done in partnership with the Pulitzer Center on Crisis Reporting.
Since 1980, the West African nation of Liberia has been through a cycle of bloody civil war that has claimed over 200,000 lives. Reporter Tisi Bole survived the turmoil and is now pushing the government to tackle a water crisis that arose during the war years, a crisis that is still claiming lives today.
Radio journalist Tisi Bole wants to know why a reliable supply of clean water to Monrovia's slums remains outside the reach of government and aid agencies.
I met Tisi at the Liberian Women's Democracy radio station on the outskirts of the capital. Her drive to report about Liberians' daily struggle to find clean water was undoubtedly shaped by growing up in a war zone.
When the war was really hot in Liberia, I would get up early morning to fetch water for my mom. As soon as the shooting subsides, I would go sneak, get a bucket or two, and come indoor. There was no other alternative. We needed the water. Otherwise, we would die.
During the war, tens of thousands of Liberians fled the violence in rural areas in search of food and shelter in the capital. A decade later, Monrovia's slums remain badly overcrowded, and those who eluded war now face new dangers.
There's a high demand for clean water now in these places because the population overstressed the already limited services.
At the Randalls Road slum, a group of war amputees tells TC that their pump hasn't worked in over 1 month. A heavy burden to those living on less than a dollar a day.
The water source itself, when we went to that community, you see there's a whole dock around the well. That means somebody who is physically challenged can't get there to get the water.
To get water, yeah, it's hard. We have to pay some of our burden to get to the well there and buy the water, bring it up to us so that we can get water to take bath.
18% of all deaths here are caused by waterborne illnesses like diarrhea, malaria, and cholera, according to the World Health Organization. One recent World Bank study found E. coli, an indicator of widespread fecal contamination, in 58% of water sources across Monrovia. These are sobering statistics for President Ellen Johnson Sirleaf, who is recognized internationally for her work on water issues. She pledged in 2008 that water access in Liberia would double in 4 years. Achieving this target is the job of the Liberia Water and Sewer Corporation and its managing director, Nortu Japa.
I visited a community yesterday, and I want to know why the water supply to that community is irregular.
Okay, so I think I talked about the issue of our capacity issue. We ration water. Most of our infrastructures have lived their useful lives, and at the end of the day, most of them needs to be replaced. And we've had a constant breakdown of machines and pumps. So it's our plan that once we have some of these technical issues reckoned with or so, we will be able to get water to Monrovia in its entirety.
How soon do we expect to see?
I would assume that probably just by the end of the year.
As proof the government was on target, Mr. Japa cited a recent project.
For the past 21 years, there has not been water on the Somalia Drive area. Just recently, the president and I, we dedicated or opened the first water main since 1990. So people along the Somalia Drive now have pipeline water.
Curious to see if rhetoric matched reality, TC left the interview and went straight to Somalia Drive. After several hours of fruitless searching, she found no evidence of water flowing from city pipes to local taps.
Since the war, it only came once.
TC did find a local man profiting from the water shortage by reselling bags of water. But he also had seen no proof the city was pumping water to his neighborhood.
Before the war, we get water all right here.
Okay.
But now we don't know where's the problem.
Kula Borbor fled heavy fighting in the interior during Liberia's civil war and came to West Point, one of Monrovia's largest slums. She arrived with her husband and 4 young children, only to face another battle.
But I didn't know because we get here, we started drinking good water. It went and hit the bag, the death from in our stomach. So he didn't make it.
When cholera took Kula's husband, she thought about going back to her village. But she stayed and now teaches her neighbors how to purify water and prevent deadly diarrhea in infants. This is life-saving knowledge in a slum of 60,000 people, where most residents buy suspect water from vendors or fetch water from dirty wells.
How do you feel when you save somebody's life with that solution you made there?
I feel happy because I don't want people to be like me. So I feel happy because when I lose my husband, I suffer with my children.
And the president said that there are water supply to communities like West Point. And clearly we went to West Point. There's no pipe water there. There's no pipe water. The people in West Point will have to buy the 5-gallon container of water.
Unfortunately, the rising urban population and waterborne illnesses are spreading faster than city pipes.
Some of these people who work in government, they have people who are working under them in their rural departments. They come back and paint a picture like everything is fine. And actually, they are not fine. I think the bosses themselves have to go on the field and see the reality.
TC's reporting exposes the gap between the Liberian government's claim it has addressed critical water problems and the actual conditions faced by Monrovia's residents. Until the government solves the problems, many more Liberians who fled the war, leaving towns and villages behind, risk losing their lives to a new foe, unsafe water.
You can learn more about West Africa's struggles to get access to safe drinking water. There's a link to the Pulitzer Center's stories on our website.